I'm really pleased that we have an introducer tonight who's just a very accomplished woman in the institution that she runs and has been running for a long time. So we have Cheryl Young here. And Cheryl Young is the executive director of the longest running artist colony in this country, the MacDowell Colony. Look them up online and see how many hundreds of Pulitzer Prize winners spent time at the MacDowell Colony. Many people winning many different awards have been there. And Cheryl herself has been there for 30 years. She's been the executive director for the last 20. So with all those award winners, she is clearly doing something very right. And we are so delighted to welcome her today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cindy. I am so thrilled to be invited to participate today, as I have great respect for Manil and his utterly beautiful writing. I came to know him when he was in residence at MacDowell in 1999 on his first book. And before I tell you a little bit more about him, one of the things we talked about was me talking a little bit about how the arts and math and STEM or STEAM sort of work together, or what their commonalities are. And I gave a little thought to this, but first let me tell you about what MacDowell is. So MacDowell gives artists a place to work in 32 studios in New Hampshire. Edward MacDowell was a composer, and his wife was a pianist, Marion Nevins MacDowell, and they founded the place on a very simple formula, which was to give artists a chance to work uninterrupted among other talented people of different disciplines. For 2 weeks to 2 months, artists work in solitude, and lunch is delivered to their studio. But in the evenings, they come together for dinner, and afterwards share their work or play pool and just relax. So I was trying to figure out how Manil made it to MacDowell, and whether there were other people like him who are both skilled in the arts and in the sciences. And so we did a query on our database, and frankly, we came up with very few people when we typed in math. But then we expanded it to technology and engineering and science, and we came up with about 100 more. But our database is about 8,800 names of people who have been through MacDowell, so that's a small fraction of people in the arts. But it's clear from looking at the query that STEM is evident in our seven disciplines at MacDowell. Through the convergence of visual art and science, mathematics and architecture and design, visual art and engineering. And MacDowell fellows are frequently exploring science writing with relation to medicine, the environment, psychology, health and food, especially issues like farming and bees, climate change and extinctions. And they're also using technology in the creation of art and using different creative approaches as technology advances to allow them to use film, video, and audio where they might not otherwise. Physically, artists working in movement and other performative genres are addressing the intersection of technology with body and the mind. And there's some very clear examples of this and smaller examples and investigations found in many of the project descriptions. Rebecca Skloot, who wrote The Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks, is at the colony right now. She's working on a new book about humans, animals, science, and ethics, a topic near and dear to her because she was, before becoming a science writer, Skloot was a veterinary technician for more than a decade. Her next book aims to help bridge the divide between animal rights activists, governmental regulation, and the scientists striving to advance research. From what I have been reading, music is the closest art form to mathematics. I think we all have heard this before. Thus, many talented MacDowell composers make a living in computer science. As a composer, it seems likely that Edward MacDowell had a mathematical bent to his mind. It is all starting to make sense to me now why Manil would thrive at MacDowell and how math is related to writing. I have a hunch about that, but I will wait to hear what Manil has to say about it. What I want to say to all of you who are engaged in math or science is that you likely have the personal characteristics to be creative. A residency could help you unlock your creative self with some of the proven conditions for unleashing it. Even if, or especially if you don't consider yourself to be artistic, replicating the conditions found in a residency like MacDowell will help you solve other knotty problems. And I can illustrate this a little bit by talking about Sylvia Nasar's book, A Beautiful Mind, about someone you are familiar with, no doubt, Nobel laureate John Nash. Sylvia is a MacDowell fellow as well. John Nash solved what is said to be one of the most important pieces of mathematical analysis in the century. His capacity to unlock one of the great mathematical challenges was aided by the same characteristics that are present in many artists: hard work, courage, persistence, and originality. Nasser quotes Nash's colleagues' observations. Many of us have the power to develop existing ideas. We follow paths prepared by others. But most of us could never produce anything comparable to what Nash produced. It's like lightning striking. It showed incredible originality. Nash's solution was described as poetic. It took great courage to attack these problems. His tolerance for solitude, great confidence in his own intuition, and indifference to criticism served him well. And he was a hard worker by habit. The qualities of Nash are like many artists. Nash is, in essence, a mathematical artist. Artists often go against the grain. That is to say, to be a truly original artist, you must believe in your ability and not be afraid of hard work or criticism. Both artists and mathematicians need an environment to nurture their gifts. I noticed a few striking similarities between MacDowell, founded in 1907, and the Rand Corporation, established many decades later. Rand was set up to bring the brightest scientific minds together, but instead of forcing groups to work together, they allowed them to have private offices where they could work uninterrupted, completely free to come and go at any hour and pick their playtime with others. A colleague of Nash's who worked there said, "Mathematicians were, as usual, the freest spirits. They had no set hours. The buildings were open 24 hours a day. Each had a private office and coffee available. The architecture at Rand was designed to maximize chance meetings, as the mathematicians generally worked alone. They had space to get together to play chess or poker when they felt like it." This sounds so much like MacDowell, where we have common spaces for relaxation and community and pool tables and ping pong, in contrast to the private studios. We know from social research that the caliber of your peers and the people with whom you associate influences your decisions, your outlook, your aspirations, and sometimes even your success in life. Whether you're solving a mathematical problem or writing an orchestral piece, the quality of people with whom you share your time has the potential to raise your game. You want to be with people who are at least as creative as yourself. And by bringing people together, MacDowell, Rand, Bell Labs, universities, or MoMath, and some tech companies are designed to foment higher level of thinking. MacDowell has also one of the great advantages of a rural setting. While architecture might be said to influence human behavior, being immersed in nature helps your brain. There is so much new evidence in neuroscience today that confirms that MacDowell and programs like it work to unleash the brain, not just because of uninterrupted time, but because of nature. Biophilia is the idea that humans have an instinctive bond with nature. The theory is that this is genetic, and that mankind evolved in the presence of plants, and our brains adapted and evolved so we can survive in a green environment. Consequently, when humans are out of that environment, we experience subtle or not so subtle discord in our ability to function. We simply think better or are more calm and better able to make connections in our brain when we are relaxed. We are genetically less able to be relaxed in a city. There are at least 50 studies demonstrating the benefits of a green view, like the view out of a MacDowell studio, or the effect of plants indoors, and of a walk in the park. For example, attention deficit disorder has shown to improve in classrooms with a green view. And we know that people heal better with plants in their rooms. Lastly, walking helps us think. Stanford is conducting what is likely to be the first set of studies that directly measure the way walking changes creativity in the moment. Allowing your attention to wander in a green space creates the kind of mental space state that studies have linked to innovative ideas and strokes of insight. Darwin famously walked a path in his garden every day. Edward MacDowell must have experienced this while in Peterborough. The walks to and from his studio must have encouraged associative thinking and breakthroughs. In summary, great artists and mathematicians have personal qualities in common: tolerance for hard work, confidence in their ability, indifference to criticism, and their free spirits. They both thrive in an environment that allows them solitude, intensity of concentration, access to other great minds, relaxation, and play. Which brings us back to Manil, who review is described as deft and confident, crisp and comic. He is a person of great originality who likes to tackle our human challenges. In an interview, Manil once said, "As a mathematician, I can attest that my field is really about ideas above everything else. Ideas that inform our existence, that permeate our universe and beyond, and that can surprise and enthrall." He created his own path from his imagination, and he operates in two spheres with amazing excellence. He grew up in Mumbai and is now a mathematics professor at the University of Maryland, Baltimore County. His novels, The Death of Vishnu, The Age of Shiva, and The City of Devi, form a trilogy exploring the past and present and imagined future of India through the lens of Hindu mythology. His fiction has won several awards and has been translated into 27 languages. He is a contributing opinion writer for the New York Times, writing op-eds on mathematics, India, and gay rights. He is in the process of completing a new novel, The Godfather of Numbers, which explains mathematics to non-mathematicians. Welcome, Manil.
Thank you, Cindy and Cheryl. It's wonderful to be back here. I was here, I guess, about 4, 5, 6, 7 years ago. I don't know, we did a play.
We don't have it over 5 years. 5.5 years,
so maybe 4 or 5 years. But we did a play in this very area, and that was a lot of fun. And of course, Cheryl was describing the MacDowell Colony, and that was in 99, as you said. Wonderful place. I've been there several times back there. But this talk that I'm going to be giving you today, it actually starts the year after that visit. And that was in 2000. And this was at a place which is similar to the MacDowell Colony, but which is actually for mathematicians. And it's a place called, it's a place called the Mathematics Science Research Institute in Berkeley. And there was a conference there, and people had heard that my book was coming out the next year, which is in 2001. And so during one of the breaks, I was invited to give a reading from my first novel, The Death of Vishnu. And I did that. And afterwards, this is what happened. This was a friend of mine. And this is what he said. He said that writing a story is like creating a Fourier series that you have to find the right basis functions. I like to call him a hardened mathematician. He's a Finnish mathematician. And the question is, what did he mean by that? So that's the idea that we're going to explore here. What did Professor Pitkaranta mean by this? And the way the talk is structured, I want to give you a very general idea in the first several slides. We'll kind of look more deeply into it in a mathematical sense, and then we'll actually do an audience activity, and then we'll see how that applies to something called finite elements, which is actually my research area in math. So what I want to start with is this idea that if you've ever seen something like an audio component, you've often seen that sounds can be made, I went by that too quickly, that sounds are essentially waves, and waves are decomposable into simpler components, and these are the basis functions, the Fourier series that Professor Pitkaranta was talking about. Essentially, these are just, let's say you have some signal like this, some sort of wave, some sort of sound. They're very simple sine waves that if you add them together, you can actually build up very complex patterns out of these. For example, these four, if you just were to sum them together, you would get essentially the top silhouette. And of course, these are exactly the basis functions that Professor Pitkaranta was talking about. And in fact, if you've seen how a synthesizer works, that's the basic idea behind how a lot of these sounds can be combined and actually made into tunes. So in some sense, when you talk about sound and you talk about what are the essential components of sound, you're actually talking about these basis functions, these very simple sine waves. So now what I want to do is show you how the same idea occurs in other contexts. And while we've talked about sounds, so let's talk about visuals. If you think about an image, well, we know that images are constructed of pixels. So if you look at an image and blow it up, you'll see little pixels in there. And now each pixel associated with that are three different colors. You know, in terms of light, you have the primary colors in light, which are blue, green, and red. And by combining these, you can actually create any color. So if you're looking at each pixel, you can think of the image being made up of pixels, and the intensity of each of these components is what contributes to that image. And so if you combine all these, like in this wonderful visual, you'll see that an image is synthesized from these red, blue, and green components. And so when you're talking about basis functions for images, that's what you're talking about. And going back a lot before there were pixels and so on, we actually come to the work of Georges Seurat, a French impressionist, who came up with something called pointillism. And what he was actually trying to do was, in some sense, get to the essence of painting. And what he did was he used a lot of separate dots and essentially composed his paintings out of them. So what he was trying to do, you could say in this kind of terminology, he was really trying to get to the essence of what is the irreducible part of each painting out of which all of these are made. And so those could be thought of as the basis functions for painting. So let's ask a different question. This is what Pitkaranta was alluding to. Can you have any kind of similar thing happen in fiction? Are there basis functions for fiction? And if so, what would they be? So I want you to think of, you know, what would be the components of fiction? That's what he was telling me. He said, okay, if I think of this as a mathematician, you have these different components, and that's what you're going to be using. So what are the components of fiction? Talking about fairy tales, for example, you always have love in there. Murder, that's always a crowd pleaser. Might have a hero, and if you have a hero, probably might have a heroine. And then the most important is, of course, the villain. I know for a fact that people like nastiness in their books, so you have to have a villain. So has there been any kind of way of breaking down fiction into these components? And it turns out that this answer, this question, was answered way back in 1928 by a Russian called Vladimir Prop. What he did was he analyzed about 100 Russian folk tales. And he showed that these were all composed of the same 31 plot components. Now, these components didn't always have to be in any one particular fiction. But if they were there, they always occurred in this order. So all of these 100 fairy tales always had this. And not only that, but he also showed that there were only 7 kinds of characters in all of these fairy tales. And this was pretty amazing. You know, you have all this variation, and it boils down to this very simple thing. So the idea, of course, would be, OK, you get something down to its components, and then you want to rebuild new works out of this. And can this be done? Well, if you go on the web, you'll actually see this. You can find this website on Brown University where they've listed all possible 31 plot components, and you can check any ones you want. And if you press a button, you get a story out of it. Now, this is just, you know, it's just it's kind of nonsensical because the stories are kind of pre-made in there, and they just put them together, so they don't really make sense. So making sense is, of course, the hard part. You can always kind of combine these in any random order, but that won't make sense. So what is it that actually helps us make sense out of these? If you look in the literature, you'll see that this idea of prop is often quoted in computer-generated narration. So that's a big, hot field. There was a lot of energy being put into that, you know, at the beginning of artificial intelligence. A lot of that energy has gone into using such automatically generated stories for something like newspaper reports. So there are these newspaper reports that are automatically generated because the rules there are much simpler. These are also used a lot in video games where depending on what your move is, the video game would then have different branches that you could take. So you need to know what components you're working with. It's also being used a lot in screenplays. There was a famous book, The Hero with a Thousand Faces, that looks at narrative again through these components and the hero's journey. And George Lucas, Star Wars, said that he was really influenced by that. There was another book based on that, which was specifically for screenplay writers. And again, you know, everything was mechanized. Okay, these are the things that you have to follow, and these are your basis functions. Make sure that you put them in this order and make sure they're there. You keep hearing this one phrase, all stories are quest stories. All successful stories are quest stories. And if you think that they aren't, go back and take another look, and it'll be a quest story. And so the question is, does this actually help writers? You know, can writers like me, authors? And the answer is no, at least me. I think if you're writing certain types of fiction, very genre, something that has a real pattern to it, that could be helpful. I did go back, however, to all three of my books and check this, and it was true. I hadn't thought about them in this way, but all three of my books actually do have somebody, the main character, going on some sort of quest, which can be quite abstract. Okay, so that's sort of the one idea that I wanted to tell you about. And let me now go to something that's a little more mathematical. So I want to present the same idea in a much more mathematical form. And we're going to start with a smile, which, you know, is always nice. So that's what we want to do. We have all these smiles, these frowns, and this and that. And we want to actually model all these expressions. And let's see if there's some way of using basis functions so that we can do that. For example, if you had a computer animated face, somehow the sound went off on this, I'm sorry, but there, it's okay now. So what you want to do is you want to generate all these expressions. You perhaps even want to make this face talk, so you want some animation in there. And the idea is going to be to use basis functions. So let's see how we can use this idea to generate these. I'm going to make one simplification. Instead of having a proper smile like that, I'm going to, in this case, just introduce 9 points. And I'm going to join these points with lines. And then I'm going to say, OK, forget about the smile, which, you know, has a lot of degrees of freedom, has a lot of variability. I'm going to be content if I can generate something with 9 points joined by straight lines. And we'll say, for all practical purposes, this smile is as good as the actual one. So if you have another expression like that, some peanuts expression maybe, again, you're going to join it by 9 lines. And then you're going to forget about the actual expression, and we're content with working with this. And so now the question is, if I look at this expression, notice something interesting. It's completely determined by the positions of the blue dots, because otherwise you're just joining them with lines. So what that means, so that shows essentially that you can change this from one expression to another just by changing the positions of the dots. And this should tell you what's really happening. We've actually found our basis functions to generate any expression. It just depends on the positions of the blue dots. To elaborate, what that means is, you know, and notice I haven't had any numbers so far, no math so far, so actually let's put in two axes, that's all I'm doing. So you can actually calculate how far above the x-axis each of these heights is, and you can assign this number to each of these points. And that means that this expression is uniquely determined by this set of numbers, 9 numbers. And if I were to change these 9 numbers, I would get a different expression. So for each number, so for each set of numbers, I have an expression and vice versa. And therefore, I can do a lot of stuff with just these numbers now. I've completely abstracted the problem to numbers. For example, we talked about animation. I could actually quickly scroll through these numbers. And you know, it seems like this mouth is going up and down. It's talking or something. Here it is again. Well, I admit, it's not Steven Spielberg or George Lucas, but it'll do for the idea. And there's another thing I can do. If I have a mouth, I can actually model it with more lines, with more of these curves. I call this my $9 smile, just because there are 9 dots. It's not very good. If you want a $1 million smile, you have to actually put in more points. So you can actually put more points, and notice I got lazy, I didn't put all of them, but you get the idea. More points you put, the better you can approximate anything that you're trying to approximate. So the amount of basis functions you have, the more accuracy you can expect to get, the more you can mimic reality. OK, so let me just summarize some of these ideas, and then we'll go and see how these ideas work out in the activity. Talking about, you know, getting all these things down into their simplest forms. And the idea, which we still haven't really seen happen, is that we can use these to then make new works. We actually saw that for the animation, not so much for the stories. There are two questions that mathematicians are particularly interested in. The first thing is, are these basis functions all actually necessary? For example, had the pixels, why is there no yellow pixel? One of the reasons is that you can actually form yellow just by combining two of the other colors. So you don't really need yellow as such. And that's one of the reasons, you know, in evolution, you're always trying to maximize, you're always trying to minimize. And so that's why we don't actually have a yellow receptor. If you had a yellow one, you would have some sort of interdependency. You would have some sort of unnecessary information, which would just cloud things. And so we want to get pixels or basis functions that are completely independent. If anyone has had a course in linear algebra, what I'm looking at is linearly independent. So mathematicians might recognize that. So that's one of the issues that we're going to be looking at. The other issue, which I've already alluded to, is do you have enough basis functions to generate everything you want to? For example, supposing I just threw out one of these blue dots. I only had 8 of them. Well, that's not so serious for a smile. You can still get a smile pretty well. But then you can't generate some other expressions. So that's why you need, you know, for all those expressions, you would need to have that 9th dot. Maybe a better example would be, take the Mona Lisa. Her smile is pretty easy to generate with 9 dots or 8 dots. You get something pretty similar. But if you look at what I call my Halloween smile, well, get rid of one of those dots, and you have a completely different expression. So you want to make sure you have enough basis functions to generate what you're after. And you know, often you can add more if needed. OK, so what we're going to do now is we're going to go ahead. And I'd like everyone, you know, you have a board, and you have some piece of paper on it, and you have something that's tied with a rubber band. So I want you to free that rubber band, and you'll be, you know, putting it back together for later. What you see in front of you is this image, and you have 7 pieces, and these pieces are going to be your basis functions. So what I'm going to do with this activity is get you deeper into some of the questions that arise with respect to basis functions. So right now we are taking a very simple, think of these as basis functions. What can you generate? Can you generate this shape? And it should be, you know, these, what you're seeing are what are called tens, and the actual puzzle is called a tangram. And the idea is that you can generate hundreds of different, if you look on the web, you'll see hundreds of different examples. Common, interesting kind of puzzle that's a lot of fun. Have people managed to more or less generate the first one? And there might be different ways of doing it. This is one way of doing it. There's probably more than one way of generating the same thing. Let's flip that page and try to generate this fox. I couldn't decide if it was a fox or a cat. Is it a fox or a cat? OK, fox. So I want you to try and generate this fox now. And again, using these 7 pieces. So this is, again, the idea of, OK, we're generating these different images, works, using basis functions. That's one way of doing it. So that's one possible solution. But now I want you to go to the next one, which is a swan or a duck, whichever one you want. And I want you to complete that one. Let's give people a chance to finish. OK, great. OK, so what are people finding? What did you find?
A missing triangle.
A missing triangle. You can't cover it. If you look at the area of this figure, you'll see that it's too big. And so the best you can do is you can do something like that, but you will have one small triangle missing. And so that ties in with the idea of basis functions being able to generate certain things, but not others, if there aren't enough of them. So keep that in mind. Flip once more, and the last image is, again, depending, well, I couldn't decide if it was a crow or a vulture. What do you think it is? Vulture, I think so. Vulture. So it's a vulture. So what's happening here?
One piece left over.
One piece left over. So you can exactly, yes. So here you find that, would you say that this vulture or crow can be generated by the pieces you had or not? It can. You just don't use all the pieces. It's like you have taken one of the pieces and multiplied it by 0. Now I want to go a little deeper into this idea. Supposing you are actually able to repeat shapes. What I mean by that is, once you have a certain piece, and now the rest of it is going to be just, you know, you have to think about it. We aren't going to be using it on the boards. But once you have a certain piece, you can use it as many times as you want. So even though you have 2 of one, you can maybe use it several times. So what I mean is, let's say you had this shape as a basis function. You could then take 3 copies of it and You could combine these copies, and you could get a different basis. You could get this shape. If you had a triangle, you could take two copies of it, combine them, and you could say, OK, this piece, this square, is generated by the triangle. So what my question now becomes is, you have these seven pieces. What is the smallest set that you would need now in terms of your basis functions?
One.
Well, let's look at this. So if you look at this basis function, you don't need two of them anymore. You have two of them, but you don't need this one, because as I said, if you have one, you can use as many of them as you want. If you look at that basis function, we've already, the big one, that again was a duplicate, so I got rid of that. Now, if you look at the square, well, that's composed of two triangles. And we saw that, you know, once you have two triangles, you now have the square, don't need that. Well, what about that one? That's also composed of two triangles. So we don't need that either. How about this triangle? Can you make that out of two triangles? Yeah, you just put a vertical line. You have that made out of two triangles too. Don't need that. Finally, you have the big triangle. What about that one?
Four
triangles. You can make it into, use it by four triangles. So the answer is, as people correctly said, you only need one basis function, and that's the smallest triangle. If you give yourself this rule that once you have a basis function, you can take as many copies of it as you want, then you just need one triangle. And the interesting thing now is that you can build many more shapes once you have this rule. For example, that shape is the one you would get just with your set, but you could now take copies of that shape, as many copies of it as you wanted. An infinite number, in fact, if you wanted. And that would still be allowable in terms of what the space of patterns is that you can generate with just that one triangle, provided you can make infinite copies of that. OK, I want to go to a second puzzle, which is has more pieces. This puzzle has some circular pieces as well. And we don't have copies of it for you, but we're going to look at it in terms of, you know, how these ideas translate. So I again want to ask the question. So this has 15 pieces now. So I again want to ask the question, what is the minimum set that you need, set of basis functions that you need? How can we kind of reduce it down to its minimum? And the first thing that happens, what's the first thing that you'll get rid of? Yeah. Well, you don't know that this triangle is exactly twice that. So we aren't sure that these shapes match in that way. So let's wait for that. Let's get that. Yes, yes.
I get rid of the pieces that are around the circle.
Yes. So if you look around the circle, you'll notice that there's four copies of the same piece. And we just need one of them. So let's get rid of those. So three of those. Get rid of duplicates. Those are the three that you just said. So we'll get rid of that. Any other duplicates? Yeah, so let's... The half circle, I'll get to that. I have an order, so I'm just going to get rid of all the duplicates. That's the L shape, because there's two of them, two of those triangles, two of those trapeziums, and finally the half circle that you said. So I'm getting rid of all the duplicates. Anything else? It might be. Maybe you're right. It probably is. We'll come to that.
And I would say the same for the parallelogram.
For the parallelogram, yeah. I think you're right on both counts. Let's get rid of the parallelogram. And what I want to do is I want to talk about what you just said about the other triangles. Let's say we weren't sure. So what I want to do is I'm going to look at these six pieces and further reduce this number. But what I'm going to say is I'm going to give you an added thing. I'm like one of the wizards in one of those fairy tales. So I'm going to give you an additional boon. And that is that I'm also going to say, once you have a certain shape, you're allowed to take any size of it. You can scale it down, scale it up. Now, that's actually simply saying that, OK, remember before we could take twice that area. Now we are allowing ourselves to take any fraction of that area. You know, you can multiply it by half, one-third, one-fourth. Just the shape is the same. So if you do that, then certainly, which piece would you first get rid of?
You can get rid of the large triangle.
Or the small one, right? Yeah. I forget which one I got rid of, so let's see. But this is saying you can reduce the basis functions to just three.
One
semicircle, and then one of those with a small triangle, I think you could make that trapezoid.
Okay, we will make that trapezoid. In fact, here's what will happen. We'll get rid of that triangle. You know, I didn't get rid of the big one. I got rid of the small one. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this piece and do exactly what you said, which is I'm going to break it down into triangles. Notice I can generate that by triangles. So I don't need that. And I can do the same thing with a trapezoid, like you were saying. I can generate that by triangles, too. Now, these triangles are of different shapes, but remember I have this added power that I can take any multiple of that triangle and get rid of it. So what that means is I can get rid of that piece as well. And that's how you just get three shapes. You can't get rid of any more because you know it wouldn't remain the same shape, but you can get rid of all of these. And let's note this idea. As I said, you're allowed to not just take twice that or three times that, but any multiple of this triangle. This multiple, I will allow to be any real number. And we'll see what effect that has in the next slide, which is the final tangram that we're going to look at. And this is perhaps the most interesting because it's an ovaloid. This consists of, what is it, 9 pieces? So if you were trying to reduce this down to the minimum, what would you start with? Which pieces? Okay, I want other people to participate. So what would you start with? Which pieces would you start with? Yes, back in the duplicates. So let's get rid of the duplicates. We'll start at the top. Get rid of that because that's clearly a duplicate. That's a duplicate. That's a duplicate. That's a duplicate. What else can we get rid of? Yes?
Triangle.
And why is that? Because the triangle is a multiple of a triangle that's already there. So let's try to get rid of, let's say, 9. Let's get rid of 9. So now that leaves 4 pieces. And the question is, can you reduce this further? OK. How?
Using extremely complex mathematics, you could scale down the triangle infinitely and manage to create all of the shapes.
Well, that's
using
true.
Just
that's
the triangle.
True. That's true. Yeah, and that actually is a very interesting way of doing it because what we are talking about is a finite combination of these elements, but you would be using an infinite combination. So yes, if you allow that kind of thing, and there is a whole branch of math with that. We are still in the real kind of finite world right now. So what we're going to do is we're going to eliminate just one more piece. And someone back there has an idea.
If the bottom left one could be taken, there's like a triple smaller one on top, you could
use that for the two sides. That's interesting. I don't know the answer to that. But there's a more obvious piece, and that is this one. If you look at this sector, and this requires some proof, I had to actually sit down and prove it. It turns out that these two are similar to each other; they're exactly the same shape. So what you could do is, you could say, "Hey, wait a minute! This is actually made up of one of these pieces, and then two triangles. So by joining all these together, I could then contract it down, and I could get that small sector." So what that means is I could get rid of that small sector. But there's another interesting way to look at it, and that is that this sector, if you subtract these two triangles from it, what you end up with is this piece. So remember I said that you can multiply it by any number? Well, that number can be negative too. And what that would mean is you're subtracting things from it. So in that sense, you could get rid of that, but you could also get rid of this piece instead. And so that minimum number of basis functions you have is 3 in this case. So that's you know another that's kind of getting your mind around this idea of basis functions. Let's go now to the final part of this talk, which is on finite elements. And this is something that's you know now using this idea of basis function representation, We want to now use it in engineering. And this is how it's actually used. And finite elements is something that engineers actually developed, and then mathematicians came around and looked at it. And I'm going to give a very broad overview, very general, very kind of just the basic idea. Let's say you have a bar, and that's being kept at the same temperature, 20 degrees, at the two ends. Maybe it's frozen or who knows what. And then you're heating it, and you know exactly how much heat is going from this source. And what you want to do is you want to see what happens to the bar once it's reached steady state. So what will happen is the bar will heat up, and then eventually it'll just reach a certain temperature distribution, and that'll stay the same if everything else remains the same. So you want to see what the temperature distribution is. We don't know what this temperature distribution is. I'm just going to point out to you that no matter what it is, let's say it's this, you can actually represent it by the same dots and lines that we had from before. Again, an approximation, but you could say, OK, only interested in these 9 points. Well, n points would remain at 20. And then the other points, you don't really know what they are. But we have a way of representing it nevertheless. Another example that comes up with the same sorts of equations is if you have an elastic cord, and it's fixed at endpoints, you're pulling it downward by some sort of force, and you want to find how it deforms. And again, the two endpoints are kept same at the same point. They're kept fixed. And once again, we don't know what that is, but we do know that we can represent this deflection again by basis functions. Now, these unknowns, I'm just going to call them C1, C2, C7. They're some sort of unknowns. They're the numbers. Remember, we were taking that triangle and multiplying it by some sort of number. So they are similar to that. So these can be positive or negative. And our goal now is to find these unknowns. We want to find these 7 unknowns. And once we do that, we'll have solved the problem. Well, how do we find these unknowns? In the previous case, we knew the smile we were trying to approximate. We knew exactly what numbers to put in. Now we don't. So what we need to do is use something else. And that something else is physics. And physics tells us exactly what equation these temperatures or deflections satisfy. Won't get into that. But the idea is that once you know the input, that is the heat that's being supplied or the force with which you're pulling things, you can actually get the output, which will be either the temperature or the deflection. Now, this equation is a differential equation. Won't get into that. There's a simpler way that physics also works, and that's the idea that's used in finite elements by engineers. And that is the fact that all around us, things are always, you know, water seeks its own level. Things are always trying to minimize potential energy. The picture that you've all seen is this. Let's say you have two balls on some sort of trough like that. You don't expect the balls to stand there. What they do is they actually come down to where the height is a minimum. And if you looked at the potential, the so-called potential energy of the system, you would find that it's actually minimized there. And that's why things are physically following that rule. Well, we can use that same principle mathematically. So the idea is, OK, you have this deflection. You have this elastic cord. Could be, you know, put into different ways. You could have different deformations. The equilibrium position, this is what physics tells us, is going to be the one that minimizes potential energy. OK, so how do we use this fact? Well, we have a very simple cord. We just have something with 7 unknowns in it. And you can actually write down a formula. I won't write it down here. It's not a very complicated formula. But you can write down a formula involving these 7 unknowns, and which gives you the potential energy. Once you have a formula for that, then you can actually find numbers which minimize this potential energy. How does one do that? Well, which branch of mathematics deals with that? Someone here must have had, many people here must have had that branch. And I'm talking about calculus. If you've taken a course in calculus, one of the problems that you always get is find the minimum of this function, find the maximum of this function. Not getting into all that, but you essentially take the derivative, set it to equal to zero, and you know, as I said, probably several of you have done exercises like that. But that's what calculus comes, where calculus comes in handy. Once you have that, you can actually find these constants, and a lot of other problems can be solved by this very simple way of approaching things mathematically. The main idea I want you to think of is this ball sitting there, where if you change its position a little bit here or there, the potential energy is always more. So it's always, you know, minimized by the central point. Okay, one more thing about finite elements. What we did in one dimension, you can do in more dimensions. Supposing you have a plate instead that's being heated up, or supposing it's fixed around the edges and you're pulling it down somehow. Well, you can do the same thing, where instead of just 9 points, you can now add a point to all of these places. You can cover it with triangles, and at each node, you can have a point going up and down. And those would be your basis functions. So you can generate shapes with these basis functions. Instead of just a 1D shape, you can now generate something in higher dimensions by pulling up certain points and letting other points stay where they are. So you can do the same thing, minimize in terms of potential energy, and if something is being heated, this is an actual solution. I used a program to do this, and the edges of this plate are actually fixed. The temperature is fixed, and the heating up is going on in the middle, and you can solve these problems, you know, computationally. What I want to ask is there anything that happens when you're writing? Again, is there any sense of optimizing when you're actually doing fiction or when you're writing? Anything that we do in that sense? And one place that we do it all the time is when we are trying to find the right word. You know, you have 5 or 6 words in your mind, you put in each one of them, and you see which one fits the best. So in that sense, what you're doing is you're making a collection of all possible solutions that you know, admissible solutions, and then you're trying them out one by one, and you're optimizing. You're saying, OK, this is the best, so I'm going to choose that. That happens a lot. Anytime you're writing a story, you're optimizing with respect to, first of all, plausibility. You know, you want to make sure people believe this stuff. Is this original, or has someone else done it? So you're always trying to, as a novelist, that's something I grapple with all the time, trying to optimize. These are all, they're all unseen processes that are happening in my mind, but they're very similar in some sense. Is this something that the reader will like? Trying to optimize in terms of that. Is it clear enough? And so on. So there's a whole bunch of things that you do. The picture that you're doing is you're making slight changes, and you're seeing whether this function, whatever you're trying to optimize, whether it's better or worse. So you're always making slight changes, and you're seeing, well, how does that read? And there are more things that come up. So you know, if you look on the web, there are essays written on how we are all human beings, and we have a certain number of ways that we attack problems. Now, whether it's a mathematical problem or something in terms of writing fiction, we're actually using very similar techniques. One of them is breaking it up into smaller pieces. You know, that's one of the key things that people use, and that we've seen that in both of these. Certainly, if you're writing a novel, you want to write it in short pieces. Continuity is a big thing. There are many papers that I've done research on in finite elements, how to impose continuity once you have big pieces. And that comes up in fiction, too. You know, you have 2 different chapters. How do you actually make the transition smooth between them? Iterative improvement. Anyone heard of Newton's method? That comes up in, you know, a little after calculus, but it's a way of solving a nonlinear equation where you come up with some sort of guess and then make small changes to that guess, and that's how you converge to what you want. And that's exactly what you're doing when you're writing as well, when you're writing something. You're making these iterative improvements. So I want to show you one final example of how this all came together for me while I was writing my third novel. I was writing this novel. It had three main characters, and it had all sorts of interesting ingredients that I'd woven in. There was an elephant, there was a pomegranate, there was a goddess of some sort who may or may not have supernatural powers. And all these ingredients were there together, and all I had to do was, you know, bring them together in the last third of the book, and I couldn't do it. I just couldn't do it. So I said, okay, I'm a mathematician. Let me try to use mathematical techniques, the whole talk that I've been giving you, and try to pull this off. So what I did was these, I don't know if you can see them, but they're pages and pages of possibilities. And the idea was that, you know, I made these tree branch diagrams where, okay, if Karun, who's one of the characters, does this, then Sarita, his wife, can do this, 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 or this, and then that can proceed in these different ways, and so on. And I was basically setting up these possible paths that could perhaps be solutions and could lead me to how to bring all this together. And what I found was that a lot of these paths were not really working. Either they were, you know, inconsistent, or someone had done it before, or they just weren't interesting. So I kept going through these, and nothing worked. And then suddenly it occurred to me that I had actually proved mathematically that this novel couldn't be written. And I was just delighted. I said, wow, I've done it. I don't have to do this anymore. So I put the novel aside and I started something else. And I told my agent, I sent this. This is an actual picture I sent to my agent, my literary agent. I said, okay, this is done. I can't do it. Now, my agent isn't a mathematician. She was not able to appreciate my proof. She said, why don't you send it to me? Let me take a look at it first. And once I said, let me clean it up a little and then I'll send it to you. And once I did that, suddenly something happened. I started looking at these three characters, and so what happened was, I'd been writing this trilogy, as Cheryl told you, and this trilogy was based on three Hindu gods, and there were three characters in my novel, and it turned out these really corresponded to the three gods that I was talking about. And there was all this geopolitical stuff going on in the novel as well, with India, China, and Pakistan. And so that formed another kind of pattern of three. And there was just this recurring theme of three in there. And once I saw that, something clicked. I said, OK, this just works perfectly. The same feeling that you get when you hit a proof, you know, if you're trying to prove something, and you hit it exactly on the head, and you say, OK, that really works. So it's that feeling, that inspiration, that feeling of completeness that you get when you really struck a solution. And that, in some sense, is the most important thing that ties together these endeavors. And that is also why it's so hard, so much harder, to make new works. You know, decomposing them is one thing, but making new stuff is so much harder, because you need to strike that inspiration. So that's the most important, I would think, the most important similarity between these, and the most important thing that you have to reach for. So I've made a little video to kind of project this in terms of pictures, so let me show that to you. Well, thank you.
All right, we have time for some questions, so please raise your hand if you want to ask a question. I will bring the microphone to you. Not always the same two. Would be appreciated.
So going back to the smile thing, when you add in another, like a bunch more dots, does it make it more, like, I forgot, more
accurate, maybe?
Yeah, like more yes. accurate? Mm-hmm. Or does it, like, make it more floppy rather than just, or?
Well, so the idea is that the more work you put in, the better your results will be. That's what you expect, hope for. So if you're trying to approximate, if you're trying to replicate something with more accuracy, or if you're trying to predict the deflection with more exactness, then you have to put in more work. And more work means you have more basis functions, and that'll give you a better approximation. So that's the whole idea.
So going back to the issue of using mathematical formulas to create writing, there was a science fiction book that I read a long time ago that came to a point in the future where all art of every shape and form was being produced by computers. And the conflict of the story, of course, is if you get to that point where everything is put into a mathematical term, will it ever reach what you would truly call inspirational creativity, or is that still something magical versus mathematical?
Well, so that's the big question. You know, it's always hard to theorize what might happen. So far, we are nowhere near that, because as I said, some of the things that people are doing are more related to very simple forms of narration, like videos or newspaper articles that are very informative. In music, I think there's been more done, where David Cope? Okay, so there's someone, David something, I'm trying to remember the last name, but he has actually used computer-generated music, and some of his compositions are amazing. But again, the way he's done that is through machine learning, where you feed in a lot of compositions by Beethoven, let's say, and the computer can then generate something else that's sort of like that. So there's been a lot of work like that. One of the interesting things I read recently was that it's Disney, actually. They have a branch in Zurich or something, and MIT, some sort of collaboration, where they've taken a whole bunch of movies and then figured out how you can break down the movies into piece by piece into its components, and then look at the arc of how the story is progressing, and then compare that with the emotional response that it elicits. And using that, they hope to be able to manipulate emotions of viewers by having the right story arcs. So there's all sorts of things happening, and it's kind of soon to say.
I have a question. You presented your proof that your third novel was unsolvable. Right. Where was the flaw in your proof?
Well, I solved it, so I know there was a flaw. You can't really, there's only so much you can do with that. The flaw would be, hey, I didn't look at this one connection. You know, anytime you're optimizing with a limited set, the chances are that there's some solution out there which you haven't thought about, and so you just haven't come to that. There is optimization where you're looking at all possible solutions, and in that case, yes, you can do it, but we can't do that. We can't achieve that. So there's always going to be things that are left out, since everything is an approximation. So that's where the flaw was. There was actually something sitting there, but I hadn't really included it in that branching diagram that I wrote down.
Storytelling is a time-based art. So have you actually analyzed it to do with time as the function of time? Storytelling or script writing or fairy tale writing, mm-hmm. as a function of time, like music is a function of time,
right.
as well. There are certain art forms that are. So have you ever looked at it from that perspective?
I haven't, but the example I was giving of Disney Pictures and MIT, they have looked at it from that perspective, that they're looking at it as a dynamic thing that progresses through time and seeing the arc of the story in time and how that affects viewers. So yeah, people are looking at that.
All right, do either of you have any more questions?
Okay, so I'm wondering, why did you choose to be a mathematician and an author?
Okay, mathematician, I was supposed to be a doctor, because my grandfather was a doctor, and so I was very careful to quickly start hating biology so that I wouldn't have that fate. And then I went into physics, and we had a mathematics professor who kept trying to get me to switch to math, and he finally succeeded. So I sort of wandered into it, and there was chemistry too somewhere in the middle. And the writing was actually a hobby. I used to write maybe one story every year or two, and then it became more and more serious. And finally, you know, through great luck, I got a book that got published, and that became a second profession. So yeah, I think with the writing, it would have been fun even if I didn't have anything published because it was so different from the math. So it's nice to exercise different things.
Yeah, I think that was a great wrap-up question. Thank you. And let's give one more hand to our presenter.
Okay.